Savitri has entered the courtyard of her soul's rock-hewn temple. She is seeing on the walls of the temple all kinds of figures and depictions presenting the life of man and beast and God. There was no step of breathing men in that rock-hewn temple. All the figures were carved in stone, and there was no step of breathing men. She would not hear any man passing by. No sound, only the livingness of the soul. What she is experiencing is only the livingness of her soul. Yet all the worlds and God Himself were there. Although there is no sound, everything appeared without any movement. All the worlds and God Himself were there. For every symbol was a reality. When she is looking at the gods, all these depictions in the temple, everything looked to her like a reality. For every symbol was a reality and brought the presence which had given it life. It is the divine presence which had given life to those figures on the rock-hewn temple, on the walls of the rock-hewn temple. For every symbol was a reality and brought the presence which had given it life. That is the unique experience Savitri is having, that even the gods and goddesses on the temple rock, they are able to bring to her the divine presence. All this she saw and inly felt and knew, not by some thought of mind, but by the self, by her inner perception, power of herself, Atma Jnana. All this she saw and inly felt and knew, not by thought of mind. What can mind do? Nothing. That presence residing in these gods, in these stone gods and goddesses, what can mind know of that? But Savitri's soul is awakened and she is able to see those things. Not by some thought of mind, but by the self. A light not born of sun or moon or fire. A light that dwelt within and saw within. Shedding an intimate visibility made secrecy more revealing than the word. Our sight and sense are a fallible gaze and touch, and only the spirit's vision is wholly true. A light not born of sun, nor moon, nor fire. This is a direct reference to the descriptions we have in the Upanishad. Na tatra suryo bhati, na chandra tarakam, and goes on like that. It is that reference we have got here. A light not born, na tatra suryo bhati, a light not born of sun, na tatra suryo bhati, nor moon, nor fire. There the sun shines not, and the moon has no splendor, and the stars are blind. When you are face to face, then the stars are blind. There these lightnings flash not, nor these thousandfold energies. There the fire burns not, has no light. A light not born of sun nor moon nor fire, nor fire. A light that dwelt within and knew within. It is that light which is within the soul. It is that which is seeing all those presences into stone carved gods and goddesses. Shedding an intimate visibility, such closeness because of that light, visibility, made secrecy more revealing than the word. What word can I express? What words are unable to describe? It is that which Savitri is seeing with a sort of an intimate visibility because of that light. Our sight, because why? Because our sight and sense are a fallible gaze. They are not dependable always. And touch, and only the spirit's vision is wholly true. What is true is only the spirit's vision. So what Savitri is seeing, she is seeing with the vision of the spirit. As thus she passed in that mysterious place, she is going from door to door, inward, inward, inward. As thus she passed in that mysterious place, through room and room, through door and rock-hewn door, she felt herself made one with all she saw. All the divine presences residing in the stone statues, she felt she herself was that. A sealed identity, she has established identity with them. Within her woke, she has at once identified herself with all those presences. She knew herself the beloved of the Supreme. Savitri knew herself that she is the beloved of the Supreme. These gods and goddesses were he and she. These gods and goddesses were the beloved and the Supreme. She has experienced that thing. She knew herself the beloved of the Supreme. These gods and goddesses were he and she. The mother was she, of beauty and delight. She is Lakshmi, the beautiful, the charming, the most harmonious. The mother was she, of beauty and delight. Lakshmi, with companion, Vishnu. The mother was she, of beauty and delight. The world in Brahma's vast creating clasp. Brahma, the creator, he is holding in his arms his spouse, Saraswati, word, Brahma, the power of expression. He is holding in his arms the word. The world fusions on Almighty's Shiva's lap. Shiva on his lap, Parvati sitting, world fusion. She is the power of this world. World fusions on Almighty Shiva's lap. The master and the mother of all lives, watching the worlds that twin the God had made, the master of this creation and the mother, they are watching this whole world here, watching the worlds that twin the God had made, and Krishna and Radha forever entwined in bliss, in happy union. Krishna and Radha always tied together. The adorer and the adored, self lost and one, they have lost into each other, they have become one. Adorer has lost himself in the adored has lost herself in the adorer. a seated identity within her woke. She knew herself the beloved or the supreme. These gods and goddesses were he and she. The mother was she of beauty and delight. The world in Brahma's vast creating clasp. The world fusions on Almighty Shiva's lap. The master and the mother of all lives, watching the worlds their twin god had made, and Krishna and Radha forever entwined in bliss. Anandamaya Purusha and Anandamaya Prakriti locked together. The adorer and adorned self lost and one. In the last chamber, while Savitri is going from chamber to chamber, from room to room, crossing door after door, in the last chamber, on a golden seat, one sat whose shape no vision could define. It is impossible to describe that vision Savitri is seeing there. Only one felt the world's unattainable form. Yes, that is the source of this world. She only feels that, yes, everything comes only from that source. One felt the world's unattainable found, a power of which she was a straying force. Savitri realizes that, yes, she is the power of that undefinable presence there. Only one felt the world's unattainable found, a power of which she was a straying force, an invisible beauty, goal or the world's desire. That is what the world is striving for. The urge of this world is to reach the invisible beauty, the sun of which all knowledge is a beam. It is a small part, this knowledge of ours is just a small part of the sun of full knowledge, full splendor. An invisible beauty, goal of the world's desire, a sun of which all knowledge is a beam, a greatness without whom no life could be. Had that not been there, this life would not exist. It is that greatness Savitri is approaching, is nearing, is seeing. Thence all departed into silent sleep. While she is witnessing these powers and presences and the source of this creation, she also sees that everything has departed into the silent cell, and all became formless and pure and bare. No figure is there, no gods, no goddesses, no creature, nothing. And all became formless and pure and bare, the true absolute. Then through a tunnel dug in the lost, in the last rock. Then through a tunnel dug in the last rock, she came out where there shone a deathless sun. She is entering into a region now where shines the deathless sun. Then through a tunnel dug in the last rock, she came out where there shone a deathless sun. A house was there, all made of flame and light. And crossing a wall of doorless living fire, there suddenly she met her secret soul. A house was there, all made of flame and light, and crossing a wall of doorless living fire, then suddenly she met her secret soul. It is that place to which Savitri was guided by the wise sage when she was in search of her soul. She has now come to that point, a house where all is made of flame and light. And she is crossing the last door, and suddenly she meets her secret soul.